And stop here. He's taking his time. I think recording has started. So good afternoon, all of you. We were discussing about, Manu, the social laws. And if you remember in the last class, we ended our discussion by comparing, the personality of an ideal king. With the awesome and the personality is something deeper from within, and Manu has also prescribed certain virtue of a king, what a king should possess, and king to be free from corruption, but true to the dharma, artha, kama, and moksha. So the king and corruption are quite opposite to each other. The king, should do the dharma, artha, kama, and moksha. Right? Maybe there I have ended. So today we will continue where we left in the last class. And to Manusmriti, state is constituted of seven elements. Whether it is Vedvyas, Kautilya, or Manu, their philosophy is very much similar, to one another, right? So, in the Kautilya Arthashastra, then you will find the seven prakriti of the Rajya. Seven elements of the state, and Manu also spoke about Saptang Rajya. The concept is called Saptang Rajya. Seven prakriti, seven elements of the state. And what are the seven elements? The Swami, the king, a ruler, the Amaitya. And that is, minister, then the Janapada, that is actually Jana means people, or one can say the state and its people, that is Janapada. Then Durga is called the court or the capital. Then the Kosho is actually the ruler's treasury, right? That is, Kosho. Again, some problem happened. So Koso is the ruler's treasury. Then there is Danda. Danda means basically it is army. Then Mitra. Mitra means friends. And all these, seven prakriti or seven elements, they are very much interrelated to each other. And as a whole, they constitute you know, the strength of the state or the key. You know, in the Sukra Niti Sara or Niti Sastra, in Sukra Niti Sastra compares the Saptanga Rajya with the human body. You know, the seven elements in the Sukra Niti Sara or Niti Sastra, the seven elements were compared with the human body, and it reflects the organic theory of the origin of the state and how all these seven elements are related with you know, with the human body. Now the first you know, the king, the or swami or ruler, the king is actually the head. I mean, head means this head. And the minister is its eye. I mean, the king is the head of the state. If the state is an individual, then king is the head part of the human body. And the ministers are the eye. And the allies are the ears. The, you know, treasury you can talk about kosho, treasury is actually the mouth, and the army is actually you know, the mind, and the capital kosho capital is its hand, and rashtra is its you know, feet. All these seven prakritis are complementary to one another. If one is defective, the state cannot function you know properly. So like Vedvyas, Manu believed in the existence of an organic unity among various elements of the Rajya, where all elements work harmoniously towards one ideal. So all these seven prakriti or seven elements, they are having distinct, you know, identities, you know, distinct significance, but all are, you know, interconnected and interdependent, and all works harmoniously towards one goal, and that goal is to protect the dharma. So all these seven elements, they are there because they have to protect the dharma. Now Manu's king is an ardent supporter of the divinity principle, and he also believes in the Matsyayana or Matsyanyaya. So Manu conceptualized king as the king must believe in the Matsyanyaya, and the king must have divinity in his personality. So both these Matsyanyaya and divinity are actually opposite to each other. So divinity basically means it is, you know, moral, and Matsyanyaya is actually the natural. So the king must have, you know, both these qualities, qualities of morality and qualities of natural qualities. So what is this Matsyanyaya? If you remember in the previous class, I told you it is a war of all against all. I mean, in a samanda or in a sea, the big fish, you know, eats the small fish. So if you have you know, power, then you have the you have the freedom. If you don't have the power, then you know, the bigger fish or the powerful person can you know, exploit you. So that is Matsyanyaya, and the king must you know, should be the believer of this Matsyanyaya. So far as you know, enlargement of his territory, you know, concerned. I mean, you cannot apply the moral principles when you are fighting against the other power, or to win the territory of the other king, right? But domestically speaking, that is something that international relation. But there is a two kinds of politics here. One is domestic politics, and another is the international politics. So in the international politics, this matsanya, king should have the quality of kings should believe in the matsanya for enlarging his own territory and strengthening his own state. But so far as the domestic politics is concerned, the king must have the divine or divinity, principles of divinity in his personality. And along with that, the king must apply the danda based on the dharma sutra or dharma shastra. So whether it is domestic or international politics, whether it is domestic politics or international politics, the concept danda is actually the core point where both these politics are being guided or implemented. So punishment meted out should be in proportion to the severity of the crime committed. So your Manu sounds very secular. I mean, the punishment cannot be more than the crime. I mean, there are different kinds of crime, and there are different kinds of punishment. If the severity of crime is high, then there will be a very strong punishment. But if the severity of crime is very low, then you will have a very small punishment. So to Manu, the Lord means the God, and God created danda, and for the sake of the king and kingdom, since king is the embodiment of the God, or king is the embodiment of virtue or dharma, so danda is there for the sake of king, or for the sake of king and kingdom, I mean for the sake of dharma indirectly. And danda not only rules over the people but also protect them. So the ruling of danda is actually the ruling of dharma. So danda is there to punish people, and through punishment the danda tries to protect them. So in one sense, danda purifies our sin. Suppose I'm guilty. There is a sin, or there is an act of omission or commission I committed. So danda, after danda, after getting the punishment, I feel relaxed, and I feel that okay, right now I'm normal. I mean, internally the purification will come, and I will also live like a normal person, not living like a guilt. So danda not only rules over the people but also protect them. The whole world is kept in order by the fear of danda. So here Manu is also, sounds like Machiavelli. It is better to be feared than to be loved. So it is the fear that rules, not the love. It is the fear that wins, not the love. And Manu, he is also the, similar version like Machiavelli, that the entire universe, the entire world is guided by, or is kept in order because of the fear of punishment or danda. The king who is truthful, wise, virtuous, efficient, and impartial is justified to use danda. So who can use the danda? The king can use the danda, but to use the danda, the king must have certain you know, qualities like the king first, you know, is truthful, he should speak truth. The king must be wise, he should not be unwise. The king should be virtuous. The king should be efficient. The king should be impartial. Then only the king is qualified to you know, give or use thunder. On the other hand, a king who is corrupt or deceitful is destroyed by the same thunder. So thunder has a double-edged, you know, sword. So on one hand, thunder gives a kind of justification for the king to use it. On the other hand, the similar thunder is also destroying the king if the king is actually corrupt or deceitful. And he is destroyed along with his relatives, kingdom, and no individual is exempt from the king's thunder. So when I'm saying this similar thunder is destroys the king, it not only destroys, you know, destroy him, the thunder not only destroys the king, but also it destroys the relatives of the king and the kingdom of the king, right? The king can be punished by the thunder, but at the same time, when the king is punishing, then there is no exemption for any particular, you know, individual. So no individual is exempted from king's, you know, thunder. So thunder for security of the person and property, as well as stability of the social order. So this is again, you know, a positive justification of the thunder. That what is the justification? Now thunder is to secure the person and his property. That is the first function of thunder. And second function of thunder is it is to, you know, maintaining the stability of the social order. That is the second justification of thunder. And power and force should be used judiciously after ensuring that the punishment is given only to those who were actually found guilty, with the intention of correcting them and at the same time serving as a warning to others. Now this is very important, and in a, you know, it sounds like that this is the version of modernity or post-modernity, where it is saying that Monu is saying that power and force cannot be exercised, you know, in an unjudicious manner, right? So power and force can be used after, you know, the judiciousness of it is clearly, you know, examined. And you know, after you are clear that the punishment is jaiz, I mean the punishment is a due punishment, and after you sure that, or you are sure that somebody is a guilt, right, then you can give the punishment. So you cannot give punishment arbitrarily. You cannot give punishment out of emotion. Rather than, you need to be sure about whether the person is guilty or not. And the intention of punishment, that is a very important point. The intention of punishment is not to punish that individual, but to, you know, correct them, you know, but to correct the guilt person. And at the same time, the purpose of punishment is to give a warning to the others that if you do this work, then you are going to face such kind of consequences. Now, in the seventh chapter of Manusmriti, there are eight types of duties for the kings. And the duties, you know, are concerned with income, expenditure, maintenance of the conduct of the personnel, building roads and ports, then building ties with the allies. And the king must treat all subjects equally and be free from any kind of apathy towards any section of the people except the guilty. I mean, there is a equality or equality of law or equal protection of law. And what is actually mentioned in our Indian constitution, Monu at the time he said that every individuals are same before the law except the guilty. I mean, except the criminals are not same as the civil individuals. Criminals are actually they are different kind of individual, and they should not be compared with any kind of civil individual, right? The king must treat all subjects equally and be free from any kind of apathy towards any section of the people except the guilty. The king should always take the counsel of learned individuals. Now that is very important today, especially Odisha politics is concerned. And today the recent ordinance brought by the BJP government that speaks about validity of this point, that why the king should always take the counsel of learned individual. It is the learned individual that they make this system. Here learned individual means who? All the university teachers and experienced teachers, those who are creating individuals for the executing of laws. These are the So is it audible? There's some problem in the internet I'm facing. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
So the king, I was telling that the king should always take the counsel of learned individual, and I gave the example of Odisha. And the most important duty of the king is to defend the state or the Rajya.